But deliver us from evil. your name. Great is your name forever, Lord. Great and greatly to be praised. Oh, great is your name.
Of your grace, flood my soul with the glory.
and spirit rain, latter rain, heaven's rain, abundant rain. Oh, spirit rain, heaven's rain, latter rain, abundant rain. Oh, spirit rain.
Standing in my inner man,
And I see Jesus living in me. And I see Jesus in everyone born again. Blood and water testify of this resurrection life. The price you paid at Calvary, crucified, set me free. Oh, bread of life, perfect sacrifice, Messiah, Messiah, and I fall at your feet. Yes, I fall at your feet. Yes, I fall. You gave. And thank you for this life I now live in you. And thank you for the price that you paid. No greater price. Life and love that you freely gave for me. Forever will I see. Forever will I see. Your praise, let your praise, let your praise, and I fall at your feet, Lord, I fall. I fall at your feet and worship you. Yes, I fall at your feet. Yes, I fall at your feet. Yes, I fall. Your praise, your praise, and I fall at your feet. Lord, I fall at your feet. You shall fall at your feet and worship you. Singing, thank you for the grace that you gave. Oh, what grace! Thank you for this life I now live in you. And thank you for the price that you paid. The life and love that you freely gave for me. Forever will I sing. Forever will I sing, oh Lord. Forever will I sing. Forever will I sing, oh, forever will I sing, forever will I sing, oh, forever will I sing, forever will I sing your praise, your praise. Let your praise, let your praise, let your praise. And this sings my soul. This sings my soul. Yes, this sings my soul. Yes, this sings my soul. stands, sings my soul. Yes, there sings my soul. Yes, there sings my soul. Sovereign is your name, the wonders of the universe. Declare your mighty faith, Lord Jesus. We give you praise. We give you praise, Lord. Praise Him in the sanctuary. Praise Him, He is saved. Come let us worship, come let us rise and sing.
Amen. Hallelujah. He is mighty, and his name is glorious. He is mighty, and his name is wonderful. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glorious great high priest. Jesus, living God, eternal Word. Jesus. Don't worry, he gets drunk in the Holy Ghost real bad. He ain't even seen nothing yet. He's fine. Please. We one drunk in the Holy Ghost people. I know we a strange lot. This is the way we get up for breakfast. We start like this in the morning. We just get worse as the day progresses. Some people have a visitation. We went into an habitation. Some people have moves. We're living in the life. Whoa! Blessed is the name of the Lord.
Lord Jesus, you are my
you make.
This is a special verse. Everybody that knows it, please join along. Get a set of a tear on jelly, mama, save the vest to toy. Get a valam, a chair and bind a salam. Give a love a care and sure, my chair. This is a monkey, salam, and the door of soot to sincere. Get a vest in jar on a nail in a dear eye. Jelly valabastico torasso. Dele be mandangelo sotto storam, deve valere be chevrangelo fosse turaia, ziralo, vile nama cele vera, ma sulle vecchiera mande sotto, che le beve se mette, con la vostra mai, gliele ve le besti su. Everybody shout to the Lord, lift your voice and praise the King, già le veste su, già le beve cotto su, beve le cosa, beve le vele per cui. Jelly baby cousin, jelly baby care, jelly baby cousin, jelly baby care. Just some damn baby baby kisses too. Just say, man, lift your voice and praise His name, lift your voice and praise the Lord, lift your voice and praise Him, lift your voice and praise the Lord. Lift your voice and praise Him. Jesus, you are the Word, the living God, eternal King. Come reign, come take your power and reign. Oh God, take your power and reign. Father, we pray in Jesus' name that Christ Jesus will come and take His power and reign. Father, we thank You that You come to gather us all into one place with one purpose, with one identity. Father, that all the tossing to and fro and back and forth and all the indecisions of the hearts of Your people would come to an end, and they would accept this unspeakable gift that You have given, this wonderful privilege to live out our life, no longer knowing ourselves after the flesh, but knowing ourselves after the Spirit, having been born of Your Spirit, having been recreated, shaped in Your image and Your likeness in Your righteousness and holiness. Oh God, oh God, let the revelation come. Tonight we pray that Father give You the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ so that the eyes of your understanding will be opened, that you might be able to perceive what is the greatness of the power of God that was given to us. When he brought us into a place with him where we are born of his spirit and given the sonship that he alone possesses, the exceeding greatness of his power that was given to us when God raised Jesus Christ from the dead, set him at his own right hand in the heavens and poured forth the promise of the Father, the gift of the Holy Ghost, which has endued us with all that which Father has, everything that belongs to the Lord. He's made it. He's supplied it. It's time that people quit remembering their former life in this world, and people stop fixating on all the problems and start looking at the glory of the answer that abides alone in this glorious redemption. Far above all principalities and powers and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in the world to come. And he's given him to be the head over the church, which is his fullness, the fullness of him that filleth all things. Oh, my. No. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the word, the eternal word, Christ Jesus, our Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for getting together with the Father and giving us the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you come to reveal Christ Jesus and make him known, and only him known. Thank you, Jesus, that you come to reveal the Father. Wouldn't you like to see the Father?
Yes.
Hey, listen, would you like to see the Father and see him dwelling and living in you? And wouldn't you like to see the Father and see how he's made everything new? And wouldn't you like to see what the Father's done when he placed you and I in his only begotten Son, Christ Jesus, and made him one with us and made us in him and him in us indistinguishable forever? The gospel's going to be heard one way or the other. Hallelujah. 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 Joshua, let's just sing that one song that we just did the other night. The Lord gave us on Wednesday night. Just sing that one song. Hallelujah. And then we're going to have Pat and Karen come start sharing with you. We have purposed by the power of the living God to manifest Jesus Christ to you, so that you may see that eternal life which was with the Father and was revealed unto us. That you may come to know in a life, a God kind of life, the life of Jesus Christ, a life that is called eternal in the heavens, one that is undiminishing, one that is so extraordinary and so exceptional. The only thing that Jesus could say is, it's abundant life. I got life for you. I got a God kind of life for you. You have to decide tonight. Many people want to live their own life. They want to live in their issues. God presents a gift. Father told me he's going to start sending me to churches and telling people it's time to receive the life of Christ. It's time to receive it. It's a gift. God's given it to us to live with power and authority and glory. Hallelujah. Baptized us in the Holy Ghost and fire, so that we might have a life indistinguishable from him, the citizens of heaven who've invaded the earth with his power and with his glory. Hallelujah. Tonight I believe that there are many of you. Father tonight will set upon you an anointing. He will give you an anointing, a special gifting and ability by the Spirit of the Lord to preach the gospel, to proclaim good news. The good news is the days of your captivity are over. There is no more power of sin that may rule you. You have all authority over every demon spirit, over every power of the enemy to tread upon it, to smash it.
Thank you, Jesus. 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 Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
for the Holy Spirit and power. For the Holy Spirit now.
Come on, lift your hands and cry out.
The Holy.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Do it again.
Oh, thank
Do it again.
You, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Oh, we see.
Thank you, Jesus.
Do that louder. Begin to thank him all over the house.
Thank you, Jesus.
No. You got to do better than that. You got to thank him. I'm telling you, with a thankful heart. With a thankful heart. Sing it again. Sing it again. We sing.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, we sing.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit and power for the Holy Spirit
for
the Holy Spirit and power.
One more time we say
thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Iria la 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 masoke. Sunereria larebea sokea. Holy is the Lamb of God. Holy is the Lamb. Sundia la da 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 soke. Just for a couple of more seconds, can you praise him? Can you join the saints and the angels around the throne for just a moment saying, Holy is the Lord God Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain from the foundation. He's the chief cornerstone. The I am that I am. The lily of the valley. Oh, the bright and morning star. The fourth man in the fire. The propitiation of all my sin. He is grace revealed. He is freedom empowering. He is glory of the heavenlies.
He's in this room tonight. Holy is the Lamb of God. Worthy is the Lamb of God. Let every tribe and nation say, holy is the Lamb of God. Taketh away the sins, restores my spirit. Oh, there's freedom here tonight. Somebody praise him. Come on, let's praise him. Let's praise him. Let's praise him. Come on, let's praise him. Hey, na 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 baso kaya se. Suriya na na base yoko. Hey, se kabase. Do you know who you are? You are a mobile upper room. When you walk into places, demons ought to be diving out windows. There should be something inside of you that caused the enemy to shrink back. Because we are not of those who shrink back. And what you got to understand is God is raising up. He's raising up his voice, his ambassadors, his declarers of truth. He's raising up the ones that have diplomatic immunity to the lies of the enemy. We're ambassadors. You know what that means? I can park anywhere I want to park. You know what that means? I'm a stranger and I'm a pilgrim in this land. See, church, when I get to heaven, I don't want my lifestyle to change. You still with me? I want to walk into heaven with nothing left to do. I want to walk in having done everything he told me to do. I having done everything he notched in the book. I want to get to the very last line and say, take me home. Oh, let's give him one more praise. Come on. Is there any remnant in the house? I want you to be seated for just a moment if you can. I'm so stirred in my spirit, and you guys can stay up here for a second if you want. And oh, I love this entire worship team. Aren't they gifts from heaven? Don't they just carry the glory of the Lord inside of them? You have to understand for just a moment, and I'm going to turn it back to our pastor. And by the way, I want to say to him, because he truly has, I leaned over to Karen a moment ago, and I wasn't going to do this publicly, but I tend to do that. And so I leaned over to Karen, and I said, I'm going to ask him to become, to allow me to become a disciple. And it's been a long time since I looked at someone and said, disciple me, carry me, walk with me. Now, already you're on my board of directors, but it's got to go deeper than that. You get what I'm saying? I leaned over to Karen, and I said, I need him. I said, I need him. I said, I've never met anyone like this. God has blessed this house with two of the purest apostolic prophetic voices. And really, when you see Pastor Mark up here, I see the Old Testament prophets, man. I'm just like, I'm scared. And I'm just like, he's going to split the altar. And I'm serious. I honor you. I honor you. And the night before Father's Day, which I believe is the most lost day in America, because 34% have grown up without dads, 72% in the inner city, and we watch and we see a generation hurting. I honor you the night before Father's Day. This is my burden is the fatherless generation that have grown up wondering why dad won't walk in the door. And so when we scream out and we go to these large conferences or small conferences, or because we don't ask where we're going, we just go. And all of a sudden, come tomorrow, in fact, Monday, I'll be in Mississippi with probably 60% of the young people that will be there will be fatherless. They come up and they grab me. By the end of the week, they walk up and they say, hey, will you be my dad? And the Lord, for some reason, has not allowed me to be released from speaking to teenagers at 45 years old, 46, in about 3 weeks. Don't forget, send a card. And so, but I want to just one more time, I want to bring you honor. I believe in honor. And in this house, do we love our leadership? Come on. not done praising. Be seated for just a moment. I'm going to share something, and then the most amazing, pure woman I've ever, ever, ever encountered in my life is going to come in just a few moments and bring the bread. And I hope you've got an empty plate because it's going to get filled up quickly. I don't know about y'all, but I love buffets. Amen. It bothers me they make you get a clean plate because then they see me go up there and grab another plate. Anyway, the Bible says in Hebrews 11, verse 6, by faith Noah, knowing that it was going to rain, built an ark. 4 years ago, God set me out on a journey, and he said, if you are tired of living wondering if I can provide for you, let me take you on a journey. And over the last 2 or 3 years, Karen and I have been through this encounter of understanding the faithfulness of the Father. You know, the last thing we should worry about is finances. I'm being serious. If he owns it all, if he's my dad, I don't want to get to heaven and walk past rooms and have my Savior look at me and say, you could have had that. You didn't ask. And the Bible says, with thankfulness of heart, do not have any anxiety. Philippians 4, 6, it goes on. But with prayer and petition and with thankfulness of heart. That's where we miss it. God doesn't like whiners. I'm serious. I don't know about you, but if your kids ever come whining to you, you're just like, okay, come back later and let's try it again. Are you with me? But it says, with thankfulness of heart, make your petitions known before the Lord. Karen and I, we began to do that in the power of agreement. We began to write out every single need we had in like 4 pages. We pray them to the Lord every day. We've never, ever, ever not seen God do miracles. Are you with me? When you begin to come in agreement, husband and wife, every day, pray your needs to before the Lord. Lay them out with thankfulness of heart, not with groanings and all the other stuff, not with whining, but you go before the Lord and say, Lord, we thank you that our kids are saved. See that which is not as though it were. We thank you that we will die and be able to pass on an inheritance. Psalms 37, verse 25. I've never seen my righteous forsaken or seed begging from bread. The Bible goes on to say that they won't have to borrow. Are you with me? See, I believe in generation sowing. I believe that when I give, when I sow into what God is doing in this generation, it meets the next generation. He's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He's living into my tomorrow. He's holding my grandson as he preaches his first sermon right now. Are you with me? I believe in generational anointing. And this ministry is called to the generations. That's why since January 1st, we've seen about 25,000 come to Christ and over 2,000 called to the ministry. And those are real numbers. Give my God a praise. You have to understand, for years I could not talk about or really get up and share offerings because I personally had a poverty spirit and did not know that I did until God broke that off me. And you know what a poverty spirit is? You eat today what you need for tomorrow because you don't think God's faithful enough to meet you tomorrow. But what you got to understand is Hebrews 11:11, one of my favorite verses, the only time you'll find this in the Bible, it says, Sarah judged God faithful. I love that. When's the last time in your prayer time you just said, I judge you faithful? You are judged. It's the only time God's judged in the Bible, but she judged him faithful. And so you've got to understand. I am reminded of Romans chapter 10, verse 15. If we don't send them, how do they go? So the Bible goes on to say, verse 13 rather. In fact, it goes on to say, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel. Are you with me so far? And what you got to realize is God is calling us to rise up with a holy fire. All the stuff, we have been serving economies when the economy is called to serve us. It's an entrepreneurial anointing. It's an anointing that says he gives the ability to create wealth. It's the anointing that says he takes pleasure in my prosperity. He's my dad. He's my father. He is Abba. The first time I held my little girl in China and I took Abby in my arms, she reached up at about 9 months old and rubbed my face and said, Baba. She instantly knew I was her father. Okay. Listen, we live in a new covenant. Jesus said, ask, seek, knock. He said, come into agreement. Matthew 18. So you've got to understand that when you begin to believe that he wants you blessed, you don't own anything. He'll give it to you if he can get it through you. It's that mentality. Oh, you ain't getting this yet. You ain't shouting. Y'all get quiet when I start talking about finances. But you got to understand, there is a moment where you say, my God is so much bigger than that. When's the last time you took your bills you get in the mail and put them on the ground and stood on them and said, you're under my feet. You have no authority. You will not control my emotions. You will not control our marriage. Now, you need to understand, the majority of divorces take place because of finances. Then distrust. Then all the other stuff. But finances destroy marriages. And there comes a moment where a husband and wife, I'm going to talk to you. I'm going to just shepherd for a second. There is a moment where a husband and wife begin to say, if we ain't got enough for our harvest, we're going to sow the seed. When what's in your hand will not feed you today, sow it. Cast your bread upon the water. Because when you get on that down the river down there, there's going to be a whole harvest waiting on you. See, there's a moment where you begin to understand that God is big. I don't usually do this, but God has released me to do this. An impartation of understanding finances. And you don't just go and just, the tithe belongs to the storehouse. Don't listen to some foolish evangelist or some TV show heretic telling you that it doesn't. Now, that's the storehouse. But when you begin to learn that tithing brings me up to even, and then sowing and reaping, you begin to step into a level of miracles. Listen, I ain't got time to worry about money. I got to worry about snatching people out of hell. Are you with me? I got to worry about Monday night in Mississippi when they'll be lined up to say, will you hug me? I've never been held by a dad. And what you got to realize is God is calling his people to step into a holy boldness to retake the land. We are not debtors. We're not squatters. We're possessors. Oh, you ain't shouting with me. Okay, that's fine. There's a stirring in my spirit tonight for this. Yesterday morning, I found out how beautiful are the wheels that bring good news. When our van that carries the generals all over America from coast to coast, which has over 360,000 miles on it, we found out from two different doctors that work on vehicles, mechanical doctors. I used to work on cars. I spent my summers working with my grandfather. When they let us know, it's gone. It's over. Put a bullet in her. Bury her. And all of a sudden, my team sent me this picture today, some of our students. A bunch of nobodies God's about to raise up to go grab the somebodies. Are you with me so far? These are some of them. Standing down there a moment ago, I got a text from the head of our school of ministry. He said, okay, what do you want me to do? You want me to rent a van? Cannot drive this thing anymore. I need your help tonight to believe with us that by Monday morning, we've got this thing figured out because we need to buy a van. Are you with me? To carry students all over America to preach the gospel. These kids will walk into stadiums of 10 and 20,000. They will get there. They will drive all night long. And this van, bless her heart, that's Southern right there. We say that sometimes. She's got to have dirt put on her. It's over. Nothing can be done. Two different mechanics said it's over. The ghost has left her. And so the reason why I say that is I don't believe in just sowing into need. I believe in sowing into vision. So I'm not speaking need to you tonight. I'm speaking vision. I believe over the next year, the Lord has called us to see a minimum of 100,000 come to Christ. We will see it every single week. We see thousands come to Christ. And tonight, in just a moment, with a power of agreement with you, how many of you agree with me this is going to happen in the next couple days? I've literally never done this right here, but the Lord gave me permission today. I prayed about it. I said, Lord, can I show them the van? So I had her team. I said, go take a picture of the van. We're going to bring it. I want to show you a casket. And so how beautiful are the wheels? That thing's had its oil changed every other week. But what you got to realize, and inside of it is prayer meetings that take place. It's a mobile upper room. Kids cry out to God. It's our rule. Once you get on the road, you pray in the spirit for hours. Sometimes they drive 24 hours to get to different places. They drove to California with me in the summertime from Alabama. They drive to New York. They drive to Pennsylvania. And they pull in, and we've never had an accident because our God's big. Are you with me? We put angels. We've got angels all around that thing. And so it's time for the angels to move to another one. And so I am asking you to pray with us because we need to see about a $20,000 miracle to make this happen. We've already been on the phone, even with one of our board members. It's going to help us get a vehicle. And we don't know if we're going to go with that one. It's kind of old already. I'm just so tired anyway, I think it's time to do something new. Are you with me? And I promise you there's no guile in this. I promise you there's a purity of this. But will you be a part of this? Pastor, would you come? And then in a few moments, I'm going to introduce you to a prophetic voice for the night. I love you, Pastor.
We love you too, Pat and Karen.
Welcome, everyone. We're so happy that you're here with us tonight. We are coveting your blessing in God. We know Father has given us a promise that he's already fulfilled on, he's already made good on, and that is that he has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. There are conditions with that, and I don't want to say too much because I really don't need to add much to what Pat just got finished saying, but I want you just to take note of the condition that the Lord Jesus has given us in Matthew chapter 6 concerning divine provision. I'm telling you right now, divine provision is a whole lot of provision. And Father is just calling us to a place to get past ourselves, to where, because we just trust in our own financial plans. We trust in our own budgeting. We trust in our, I hate to tell you, but really, by and large, it comes down to the arm of flesh. And Jeremiah said like this. He said, cursed is every man who trusts in the arm of flesh. That is not a good thing. He said, blessed is he who makes the Lord the sole object of his trust. Jeremiah chapter 17. Here is our challenge. The Lord Jesus preaches a sermon to us. And, you know, in most translations, he says, take no thought. But the Greek language, the word literally means to be concerned. So don't take any concern. Don't be concerned at all about your clothing, about your basic essential needs in life, about your mortgage payment, about your rent, about your food budget. Don't be concerned about it. I got that already. I got it. Now, this is the big tension because we're like, really? As they say in Japan, oh, really? Really? Yes. And Father tries over it again to prove to us that it's true, that what he said, what he's promised to do, he will do it. And I know how it is, man. I'm telling you. I know that sometimes the Lord doesn't he doesn't come through for us, it seems, at the most convenient times. It's like, wait, Lord, I think you're a little bit late. But, you know, he has the right to try us because he wants something to come forth in our life that is so precious to him. And what's so precious to him is faith. It's more precious than the finest of gold, the most valuable thing known to man, a real commodity of value beyond diamonds. Of course, we know that's a made-up, inflated value. Gold is the purest value thing known to man. And here Father says, there's something so precious to me. It's your faith. And he says, hey, we rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, having received the end of our salvation. But if it's necessary, some of you are going through some serious situations. Some of you are going through some trying times. Because there needs to be an evaluation of what's truth and a recognition of what Father has promised. He will make good on it because it's all been about from the very beginning. I want you to trust me. And he found a man named Abraham that would trust him with everything. And Father, tonight, once again, searches us. And I'm telling you, I was just telling, you know, Pat and I were talking about why we don't ever have any money in our pocket. I watched him pull all the money out of his pocket last night and put it into the offering basket. I said, yeah, that's the same way with me, man. I mean, I just can't carry cash because as soon as I hear something about giving everything to the Lord, it has some representation with the money because we trust in money more than anything else outside of God, of course, right? Blessed quietness. Nobody wants to be a liar in this place. Praise God. Ha ha. Amen means you agree and you're doing it. Did you know that? You can't force an amen. An amen's got to come out of your spirit. I don't like things coming out of people's throat. Sounds like Roller-Rama. You know what I'm saying? Instead of a praise and prayer meeting, I like it coming right out of your belly, the inspiration of God, the Holy Ghost, shouting through us. Beba, I'm going to tell you tonight, listen, we are in this for your blessing. We are in this for you to step into every dimension of that which Father has made available to us because it's the life and person of Jesus Christ that must be revealed and must be seen. And we are blessed in this ministry to be in covenant relationship with people like Pat and Karen. And what we do is we just give it all. I mean, we just give and we watch how Father works miracles. And tonight you may be saying, you know, really, I don't have hardly any money in the bank account. Don't worry about what it is. It's not how big the gift is. It's how deep, how sincere, how important, how sacred it is to you. Make sure it's sacred. Make sure it's costly. Make sure it's really something of value to him. Because when it is, I'm telling you, you touch heaven. Last night I heard some people praying at the end of the meeting, and it's like the Lord's given me this ability to know when a prayer rings in the throne room of heaven. And man, when that, and I told the person, I said, I'm telling you, when that prayer went out, I'm telling you, all heaven was dispatched to take care of that cry. Because Father demands truth, man. He wants truth in all of us, in our relationships. We want truth. We want it to be real. We don't want no falsehood or fake stuff. And Father's looking for some real stuff, spirit and truth. And tonight, no matter how small or how big it is, make it sacred. Make it something that belongs to him. Make it something that's a part of you. Because, you know, our money, it makes a terrible master. Terrible master. Where you're always serving and bowing down to it and worrying about it, wringing hands over it. But it makes a pretty good servant where you can send your servants tonight with Pat and with Karen as they run throughout the United States of America. And I was telling Pat, I'm saying, listen, man, you need to be at home more. I mean, you know, the reality of it is there's so few Pats, and we got to see more Pats multiplied so that Pat doesn't run 365 days out of the year pretty much and you know, doesn't get the family time that he needs and whatnot. So let's just do everything that God has empowered us to do. And, you know, in the Old Testament it says, really, when you come to bring an offering, you bring the offering to the point of how far your hand can reach on your tiptoes. Okay? And that's what God requires of you. You got to stretch it out there. How high can you reach? That's what you bring, and that's what's acceptable to the Lord. Okay? And some of you may be straining. Maybe you got an Achilles heel problem or whatever, you know. And it may be hurting you financially. But do it because Father sees. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He sees, I'm telling you. He will open up a spring for you in the desert. He will supply for you a bread where there is no provision. He'll give to you water from a rock. He will supply to you coin in a fish's mouth. He will give provision that comes from unforeseen places. I mean, Father has loaded us up. I mean, if I started talking to you tonight about the miracle after miracle, people look at me all the time. They go, how is Pastor Mark doing it over there? He had all that property out there on the Naval Training Center, and now he's got this place. What's going on over there? And I had one guy said to me, he said, how many millionaires do you have on your board? I said, I don't have any on my board, but I know the one who owns everything. And I tell you, faith is far more valuable than any gold. Faith is far more valuable than any offering. You can't buy your way into heaven, no protection, nothing. It's all about a trust relationship where you know God's going to do more for you than you could ever do for him. And he takes whatever little bit we give him, and he makes it, and he multiplies it through the miracle, supernatural interaction of his presence with us. Hallelujah. Pokata sananea. This is what true worship is. Vayikra, the book of Leviticus, we call in the Hebrew language Vayikra. And if you want to approach unto the Lord, the scripture says, if you want to approach unto me, if you want to get as near to me as you possibly can, then bring an offering. Bring an offering and come here and stand at the door and bring me an offering that represents your redemption. Bring an offering that represents Christ Jesus. Bring an offering that represents my salvation for you, my deliverance for you, my healing for you. Hallelujah. My wealth and my provision for you. I'm going to give you eternal life abundantly supplied with every good thing beyond all that you can imagine. It's going to last forever. Father going to take care. Listen to me. Papa going to take care of you forever. You listen to me. Everybody in this place tonight that believes in the resurrection from the dead, that believes in the life eternal that is in Christ Jesus, the life of God, he's taking care of you forever. And I tell you, don't have to wait till you get to heaven to start getting taken care of by the Father. He wants to start taking good care of you tonight. So everybody stand with me.
to stand with me. And we're saying, Father, we thank you for a miracle provision for this van and for this future for I Am Remnant. Father, we thank you right now for a miracle provision for so many people standing in here with similar needs. Father, I know that so many people are standing in this place. They got various different needs. Economic things are hanging over their head, and they somehow, sometimes they can't even get past the thought of it. It just plagues their mind. So, Father, tonight I pray in Jesus' name that they'll find a realm of trusting you, that they can just begin to bypass all of that and recognize that you're taking care of it and begin to live a carefree life in the things of the Spirit. Amen. Hallelujah. So people, what we do here in this place is we all come up and we put it in the basket. I learned it from Jesus, because Jesus was able to stand over against the baskets and watch what everybody put in. You know, somebody says, hey, you're watching over the basket. Yeah, I learned it from Jesus. You know, he said, yeah, well, that lady had just put in two mics. I mean, you gotta be paying some pretty close attention to catch that two mics in there. Okay, but that's just what we do, because we want to worship. It's about worship. It's about bringing something that's sacred, bringing something that represents Jesus. So if you're making out a check, I want you to know all of this, in the entirety of it, is going to Remnant. We don't do Remnant. We don't do overhead thing, you know. We don't do, okay, here's where the offering comes in, subtracted from this and that and the other, and expense and add and multiply and divide and whatever. It just all goes to them. So I want you to right now, in the name of Jesus, participate in a miracle. I want you to participate in a miracle. I know that you have need. I know you have things that you're responsible for, that you're accountable for financially. I know how things work in our society, our culture. So does the Lord. Tonight, you're going to move forward in a realm to where that you're in expectation of participating with the miracle provision that Father wants to bless you with. He wants to open up blessings upon you beyond what you've ever had. So come participate with that in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I thank you, Father, for the miracle right now. Hallelujah. I would just start calling out your names, but I'd afraid that somebody get upset if I miss them and think, well, they're not going to get the miracle. Hallelujah. Miracle's coming your way. Hallelujah. Miracle provision. Somebody said, how much does one breath of air cost to draw in one breath of air? Hallelujah. It's a gift right from heaven. Praise the name of Jesus. La cosa renea patana nea. Harama mama sekene. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Barra mama seteya. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Barro sekene nekila. Hale manjesikoya. Chese bananera. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for that Holy Ghost dance that you put upon Jacqueline. I pray gets more radical than ever in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. For the Holy Spirit. This is what you do when you're in situations where you need a miracle. When you're in situations where things are pressing sore against you and it looks like it's about disasters impending, or whatever problems may come at you, concerns, you just begin to say, thank you. Thank you. Now say, I praise you, Jesus. I praise you, Jesus. I thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit now. For the Holy Spirit and power. For the Holy Spirit.
Jesus. Come on, praise him across this house. Would you do that?
Come on, you can do better than that. Hallelujah. You may be seated across the house. I want to do something very quickly. Hey, would you mind texting the word remnant to 97000? Already this weekend, there's probably 1,100 or more that are praying for you. There was a prayer meeting held last night for the service last night all over the world. The Lord spoke to me at the beginning of this year. He said, raise up 10,000 prayer warriors that will be a part of the remnant prayer meeting. And all it is about every week or every 2 weeks, we send a text out and said, hey, we're in San Diego. Please pray with us for a move of God. And we start getting replies back, people going, we're going to prayer right now. How many of you know prayer is everything? Are you with me so far? And so the Lord really spoke to us about that. He said, I want you to do that. And again, thank you for, we just pray 30, 60, 100 fold, 1,000 times, Deuteronomy 111, 1,000 times blessing over the seed you just sowed. Thank you for standing with us. And again, this is home to us now. I literally am going to begin to call this house, abiding place, is our home. We're going to start telling people that because this is home to us. And, it's one of the purest places we've ever been to in our life. How many of you love Jesus? Give the Lord a praise. Come on. And some of you may already know this, about 2 weeks ago, it went to number 4 on Amazon, and we are getting reports. I let Pastor Mark listen to a text this morning of a fellow from Haiti saying, you don't understand, we're reading unqualified, we are getting wrecked by God. He's a professional NFL kicker, and he said, he's in Haiti doing a kicking camp, kids that do soccer and all that other kind of stuff, and he sent me this voicemail or whatever it's called, Voxer, and he said, I just got to tell you, I'm sitting and getting wrecked. Between every session, I am reading unqualified and getting wrecked by the Lord. Now, there's some pretty powerful stuff in this book. In fact, one is a quote. There's a powerful endorsement from Pastor Mark inside of this, but there's also a quote inside of it that we were riding down the road, and he said to me, and this quote kind of wrecked me, and I'm just like, oh, that's so good. What is the quote, Pastor Mark? You told me it's I read it to you. Satan goes about seeking as a roaring lion, seeking who he may devour. But Father goes about seeking who he can empower. Come on, give God. That's in the book. In fact, it was your mom that posted it, Josh. I saw that. And I showed it to Pastor. But I challenge you, if you don't have I Am Remnant, you don't have Why Is God So Mad at Me About the Love of the Father, we have families that are reading all three books. You can get the small group, the videos that go with it, the whole thing. Check that out. And then also, next month, let me grab it real quick. I want to go ahead and tell you, Karen's brand new book, in fact, Pastor Ann is inside of it, and her new book called Dehydrated. Have you ever felt dehydrated? The enemy's goal is to make you dehydrated, keep you from the well. And it's all about secret encounters with the Holy Spirit at the well. And you can order it tonight. She'll sign it, mail it to you next month. And I challenge you to check that out. And then lastly, we are launching something called RaiseTheRemnant.com. And RaiseTheRemnant.com is God spoke to us. And when the Lord spoke this to us, actually through our director, he texted me one morning. He said, hey, God just gave me something. And I was working out. I do that once a year. And just fell on the day, and I was working out, and the Holy Spirit, I started to say, hey, I'll talk to you this afternoon. And the Holy Spirit said, tell him to call you in 10 minutes. He calls me, and he said, you know, we've discipled thousands. We've sent out over 700 in full-time ministry. They're touching the world, all over the world. But then the Lord said, but it's time to disciple millions. And so we're launching this thing called RaiseTheRemnant.com, where every month, Karen and I do videos on the call of God. Are you with me? On everything from sermon writing to altar calls to flowing in the Spirit, flowing in the prophetic, treasure hunting, all of the things of ministry. If that's something you're interested, please go on. Put your email on there. It's RaiseTheRemnant.com. And the last thing is this. You know, with I Am Remnant, the Lord gives me a manifesto every time, the last two books actually, like The Remnant consists of the failures, the fatherless, the forgotten, and the freedom fighters whose pedigree is that of a scarred savior. Or The Remnant doesn't stop where they should have died because they know Jesus didn't. Are you with me? Well, in the new book, in fact, I challenge you, mom and dad, get this. Anybody want this? I'll give this away. This is the manifesto for I Am Remnant. Prophesy this, speak this over your children every day. If you ain't gonna get excited, I'm not giving it away because you got your joyful heart. No, that's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. Now, be a little careful because I've been run up on stages before. Hey, who wants unqualified book? Does anybody want it real quick? And Josh, okay, all right. Yeah, don't run too fast because it's scary to me. I'm just kidding. And so, anybody, who does not have I Am Remnant? Anybody want I Am Remnant? Now this book, it's gonna mess you up. You won't be. It will literally. You'll be weeping as you're because you're. It's like the emails we get from the Ukraine. We get emails from Russia. Hey, oh my Lord. Hey, I got something. Hold on. Oh my Lord. Hey, that's what I'm talking about. We just had roller derby up here. This is why it's got so mad at me. It breaks all the lies. Take that and nobody else run. And that was fun. It got scary. Y'all saw it from behind. Oh, there was fire in those eyes. And but the Lord gave me a... Okay, all right. Well, okay. This is the unqualified manifesto. You got to wear it to school and you got to scream your remnant. Okay. And so, but okay, this is a lot. No, don't anybody else. Sit down, everybody. And but the Lord gave me another manifesto, and it's 43 prophetic statements because we are the unqualified. If you don't believe that, Paul said, I am the least qualified. Now, don't get disqualified. That's all in the book, a whole section on that. Don't read it if you don't want to be convicted. And but here's one. The unqualified stay hidden in God's word so they never walk in the wisdom of the world. The unqualified never ignore the hurting because they have scars of pain to prove they have survived to testify. The unqualified know God knows that God uses the least qualified to change history and confound the most qualified. The unqualified stand in awe of the love of God that rescued from a life of pain. The unqualified understand without the active work of the Holy Spirit in their lives, they will become an echo rather than God's voice of deliverance. Let me say that again. It's pretty powerful. The unqualified understand without the active work of the Holy Spirit, they will become an echo rather than God's voice of deliverance. And so we took this, and some people would take this as an offensive thing to say it about them, but we put it at the bottom, and it says the Spitsbergens are the unqualified. And so I want to give this to you, Pastor. So that's for you as a gift. Would you stand to your feet across this house? Because the Spirit of the Lord is going to move and you're going to be wrecked by His presence. And I believe the freedom is in the house. And thank you. Tomorrow morning, I won't have time to do that. I got to catch a flight tomorrow. So that's why I shared all that. But I believe with all my heart, the Spirit of God is going to wreck this room. And I want your Holy Spirit, B12, to rise up inside of you right now. Are you with me? I want you to begin to cry out to God. Because coming to the pulpit is a woman that carries a mantle for a generation. She is a rescuer. She carries the anointing of purity. She chases the heart of God. I call her my Holy Spirit in the flesh. And she has a word for this nation. And what I love about her is when she walks in, suddenly the presence of God drops. So I'm going to turn it over to her. But would you begin to cry out to God now? Come on, cry out to Him. Lift your voices.
Just begin to cry out. God wants to do miracles in this place tonight. If you want an encounter with the King tonight, just raise your hands and begin to cry out and praise Him. Praise Him like He's in the room because He's standing right next to you. Lord, we praise You tonight. We welcome Your presence into this place tonight. Thank You, Jesus. 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 Thank You, Jesus, for Your presence. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. I want you to know tonight that my spirit is so stirred for what God wants to do here tonight. There is a moving of His presence. He is walking through this place tonight. He is walking through and He wants to encounter you. He doesn't want to just have random bump into you moments. He wants to have purposeful, intentional encounters with you. And that's what tonight is all about. He wants to bump into you on purpose tonight and have an encounter that will change you. When you have had a true encounter with the Father, a true encounter with the presence of the Holy Spirit, you will be changed for a lifetime. It won't be just a moment in time, for that was just a feel-good moment. It will be a moment that will transform your life, and you will never be the same. God wants to do that for you tonight. You might be seated tonight. I want you to know, I don't believe I have felt this stirred in a long time. The whole time we were down there, I was praying in the Spirit, and every time I would want to try to speak in the flesh, speak with just a regular voice, God would just continually just well it up inside of me that I couldn't stop just speaking in tongues. And so God is up to something huge tonight. If you have come here and you are desperate, then tonight is for you. I want you to know that God is all about encounters. All through the Bible, he has encounters with people. And not only are they changed for a lifetime, but everyone they come in contact will be changed for a lifetime. So he wants to change you so that you can change your family, so that you can change your city, so that you can change the nation back to the heart of God. That is what he wants. But I just want to take a moment because I believe in honor. And I just want to thank you, Pastor Mark, and thank you, Ann. And I just want to say tonight, I don't know if you realize tonight what an amazing woman of God that you have here in a pastor's wife. I just want to say thank you. I don't believe I have ever met anyone that is so encouraging. When I'm with you, I can't help but just be filled with joy, and I so appreciate that. You are filled with encouragement, with grace, with love, and with joy, and there are very few like that, and I just want to honor you tonight for that. Everyone give her a hand. But if you want an encounter tonight, then I want you to know that at any point, these altars are open. You don't have to have an invitation. You don't have to have someone tell you they're open, because the altar is there for your life to be transformed, and he is ready to meet you. Can I tell you tonight that the Father loves you with such an amazing love that he wants to take you on a journey. I want to allow God to take you on a journey tonight that will transform your life. That is what this is all about. And I'm going to be talking tonight because I want you to know, no matter what you're walking through, no matter what you face, no matter what turmoil you faced before you came here tonight, no matter what your family is walking through, no matter what addictions, no matter what the power of the enemy that is trying to hold you bondage, I want you to know that the power of God can transform you, can change you, can set you free, can deliver you in an instant. Because I want you to know what he wants to say to you tonight is, it ain't over. It's not over. Because no matter what the enemy tells you, he would like for you to lay down. He would like for you to give up. He would like for you to cower back. He would like to push you into a corner like a bully and keep you frightened. But my God says, it ain't over. It's not over tonight. If you'll look in your Bibles tonight to Mark chapter 5, verse 22. It says, then one of the synagogue leaders named Jairus came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. He pleaded earnestly with him, my little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live. So Jesus went with him. But then a large crowd followed and pressed around him, and a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. See, I want you to know that the blood will interrupt your life. The blood of Jesus will interrupt you. And there are those of you in here tonight that your life has been bleeding with the issues of your past. Your life has been bleeding and leaking the joy that God wants you to have, the freedom that God wants you to have. But he's telling you that the blood of Jesus can come in and it can cover you. It can wash over you and it can deliver you. The blood will interrupt you. See, it's time that we stand up in our nation once again for the body of Christ to come in and realize that we have all power, all might, all authority in Jesus Christ who lives inside of us, that has given us the authority to take back this nation for God, to take it back, to declare that he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's time that we declare that it's not over. It's time that we declare no more lies. I am so sick and tired of the enemy coming in and stealing our family, stealing our children, stealing the seed, stealing what God is giving us. I'm tired of him stealing our joy, our freedom, our passion, our purpose, stealing our family, stealing our sanity. It's time that we declare that it's not over. Can I tell you what I hear in this room tonight as I was sitting there during worship? What I hear tonight is the abundant sound of hope. That is what I hear tonight. I hear him saying, I have come like a roaring fire to come through and to bring hope to a people that have lost hope. To let them know that I'm not done with them, that I haven't given up, that I haven't thrown them to the curb, that I haven't thrown them to the wayside. He's come to bring refreshing tonight. If you will allow him, he will walk your journey with you, and he will walk every step of the way. It's time that we rise up and be brave today, to be brave and to stand firm on the things that we know that are true, stand firm in the things that we know that God wants us to do. This message is for those in here who have lost hope, who have lost sight of what God wants you to do, who have lost sight of what's important, who have lost sight of believing and having faith and walking every single day in faith. This message is for you to realize that God's not done with you. See, recently during worship, a couple of months ago, Pat and I always have dreams about floods or about a wave. And a couple of months ago, I had a dream. And I was in a service, and we were worshiping, and I had a dream that from the back of the sanctuary, there was a flood that rushed through the doors, and it began to come into the building, and it began to fill up, and the waters were rising, and everyone was down at the altar worshiping. And I looked around, and I thought, everyone needs to get out. Everyone needs to run to safety. And God said, no, just watch. And in that moment, I saw the water rising, rising to their neck, rising above, and going above them, but no one was frightened. Everyone lifted their arms and they were worshiping in the midst of the flood. And God said, that is my Holy Spirit that I am pouring out on this nation once again. And I never knew what it meant until I got here tonight. And I said, God, why would you show me that? He said, because I'm going to show you that I'm pouring my spirit out once again. And when I was sitting there in that seat, he began to bring that back to me and said, this is where I want to pour out my spirit. This is where I want to call him. But see, God hasn't changed. God never has changed. He's still the same yesterday, today, and forever. He hasn't changed the way he reacts. He hasn't changed the way he moves. We've changed. We've changed the way that we respond to his presence. God's not taken back by any of our circumstances. He's not caught off guard by our situations that we face. We've changed in how we responded to them. But it's time that we rise up and we stand up and we wake up and we grow up and we declare who he is once again. God is calling us to a new level, to a new purpose. See, in Revelation, it states that he's not done with us. And see, if you are tired in this room, if you are worn out, if you are ready to give up, then I have come to declare a word from God to you tonight that it's not over. That he's not done with you, that he's still writing the scrolls of your life, that there is something so powerful when a people begin to wake up and realize who God truly is. But Revelations 3:2 says, wake up, strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I have not found your deeds complete in the sight of God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. Hold it fast and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you. He says, it's not dead. There is still hope. You need to begin to fan into flame that little ember, that little flicker of flame that is still within your belly, that's still within your spirit. And he says, don't let it die, because I'm here to fan it. I'm here to raise you up. I'm here to tell you that it's not over and that you still have a purpose. That is where God's calling you. See, in other words, he's saying, I'm not done with you. I'm not finished writing your story. I'm not finished singing your song. See, I know having wrote a book, that I've just wrote a book, there was a lot of rewrites. There was a lot of edits. God may have seen you, and he may say, you know what? You may have made some mistakes here tonight. You may have messed up. You may have messed up so bad that you think that you can't recover, but I may have had to tear out some pages. I may have taken some chapters out, but I'm still writing. I'm still writing the scrolls of your life. Don't give up. Don't lay down. Don't pass out across the way, but just get up and keep moving and keep walking in what I have for you. See, I understand that all of creation is groaning. All of creation is groaning right now. With our nation is more divided right now than it has ever been, with the earthquakes, the tsunamis, with ISIS spreading terror everywhere, where racial tensions are higher than they've ever been. The media, the pundits, all of them try to spread terror, try to spread all of these things all over the place. They say, where is your God in the midst of this crisis? Where is your God in the midst of all the turmoil? They try to tell you that he's not there, that he's not real. They even mock him. But I'm here to tell you that my God is a God who sees all, who knows where everything is, who knows what's going on. And there will be a moment where the remnant will rise up and they will take back and they will declare victory over the enemy. Don't lay down. Don't give up. Declare that it's not over. See, there is a terrorist in our nation. There is a terrorist called lethargy in the church, and that is spread across the nation. See, the reason America is going dark is because the church has been sleeping, and it's time that we get up and we turn the light switch back on and we declare his presence once again. I am so tired of perversion and everything being celebrated in this nation when godly lifestyles are being mocked, being made fun of. See, I am tired of the enemy sitting back laughing at Christians when we have everything in us to stomp on him, to put him under our feet. We have a God that is in control. But Proverbs 14:34 says, God devotion makes a country strong. God avoidance leaves a people weak. It leaves families weak. It leaves marriages weak. See, why do we worry so much about offending other religions? We serve the one true God, the only God. Why should we be ashamed to stand up and declare, I don't believe in your God because my God is the only one that is living, breathing, active in everything that I do. Proverbs 19:3 says, people ruin their own lives by their own stupidity. Don't you love the way that God says things? So why does God always get blamed? Do you ever wonder if God gets tired of the rhetoric? If God gets tired of being called everything that he's not? Can I declare who God is tonight? God is my Savior. God is my Deliverer. God is my Provider. He's my Healer. He's my everything. He's the Lord of Lords. He's the King of Kings. And he is the Lover of my soul. That is who God is. So when people tell you everything he's not, stand up and go through that long list of who he really is. See, Malachi 2:17 says, you make God tired with all your talk. How do we tire him out, you ask? By saying God loves sinners and sin alike. God loves all. And also by saying judgment, God's too nice to judge. No, let me tell you something. You serve a God that is a great father, and he's not afraid to discipline you, to bring you back to the right track, to bring you back to the place of blessing, to bring you back to the place of freedom. That's what a good father does. See, this is the hour where we must rise up and declare with power and authority. For those of you who feel that you're at the end, who feel that time is up, for those of you who feel forgotten and misplaced, for those of you who feel relegated to the back of the room because you don't feel like you're worthy, because you don't feel like you have a voice, because you feel like you've done too much, it's time to rise up and say it's not over. It's time to rise up tonight. See, it's not over till he says it's over. It's just the beginning. I get so ticked off at seeing the body of Christ act as if somewhere along the way Christ gave up his power and his authority to be all that you need, to be all that we need, to be everything, to gave up his power to be that somehow he lost his authority. No, we lost ours. But God never lost his authority. All through history, people have given up. All through history, people have thought it was over. But this is a time where you need to raise your eyes up and look into heaven and say, God, I need you to wake me up. I need you. There are alarms going off all around us. And God says, I want to wake you up. I want to bring you to a place, that awesome awakening of you. That is what God wants. See, I feel like there's a stirring in my spirit, an awakening, almost like the sound of feet hitting the floor in the morning light. I'm talking about an awakening where you rise up with a boldness, with a courage, with power and might, and you don't give in to the lies of the enemy. See, I feel like it's your moment for you to hear God say, this is your moment to realize that I want to use you, that I want to use you to change culture back to the heart of God. I want to use you to transform a generation back to my heart. See, how many of you have ever woke up praying in the Spirit? I love it. I love waking up praying the Spirit, but I also know that it's preparation for something else that's coming ahead. I also, in addition to waking up praying the Spirit, I'm also married to a fire-breathing preacher who I wake up very often in the middle of the night to him preaching sermons on salvation. So I wake up in the middle of the night, and he's preaching, and he's calling for salvation, and the only way I'm going to get any sleep is if I look at him and say, okay, I accept the free gift of salvation, so just go to sleep. But I love waking up praying in the Spirit. I prefer that over the other. How many times can you get saved in one night? But so I love waking up in the Spirit because I know it's God preparing me for what's coming ahead. See, there are times where I've went to bed, and there are times when you've went to bed where you may have went to bed and your armor that you wore, your spiritual armor, may be tattered, it may be worn, it may be hanging off of you from all the arrows from the enemy that has hit you, that all the enemy that has been attacking. You may go to bed and you may think that you have lost the battle, but God says, in your sleep, I have sent ministering angels to refit your armor, to polish your armor, to make it strong again. I am so sick and tired of spiritual streakers running around without their spiritual armor. armor and wondering why they are losing the battle that they're fighting. See, it's time that we wake up in the morning light when God's presence comes through that window, when God's presence enters into our room, and we wake up for the light of the glory, looking up into heaven, and we say, I'm going into my prayer closet. Today I put on the helmet of salvation. Today I take up the shield of faith. Today I pick up the sword of the Spirit to fight the demonic powers that come against me. I put on the belt buckle of truth so that I will not lose my way, and I will fit my feet with readiness, so that I can take the journey that God is calling me to. It's time to put on the whole armor of God. See, revival. God wants revival. There is something so powerful when God's people begin to wake up, to stretch out of their slumber, to call their families back to Him, to go into their prayer closets, to stir the flame which once burned so brightly. And they themselves have a fresh revelation from God. That's what revival is. See, revival begins in churches when families begin to have revival at home, when they begin to go into their prayer closets, when they begin to teach their children how to intercede, when they begin to teach their children that there is a God that they can go to school with, that they can go everywhere with, that they're never alone, that they're never abandoned, that they're never forsaken, that God will never leave him. It's the secret encounters that are brought out for public display. That's what revival is. Ephesians 5:1 says, wake up from your sleep. Watch what God does and then do it. Like children who learn proper behavior from their parents, mostly what God does is love you. Keep company with him and learn a life of love. Observe how Christ loved us. His love was not cautious but extravagant. He didn't love in order to get something from us, but to give everything of himself to us. Love like that. That's what it says. God knows when you're weary. He's calling you into his presence. I'm so done with normal. I'm so done with just the everyday monotony, the everyday, it's Groundhog Day over and over. When will we get to the place where we come into the presence of God and we expect miracles, when we expect healings, when we expect God to show up, when we expect to see his presence? Matthew 11:28 says, are you tired, worn out, burned out on religion? Come to me. Get away with me and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. See, I learned a long time ago that I needed to learn to take strolls in the park with God, that I needed to take strolls in the evening with him, that I needed to learn to walk with him, that he would walk with me, that he would speak to me if I would listen, that if I would just take time to listen and to hear his voice, he would speak. See, some of you are weary in here. Your day started out warring just to get here today, just to get here tonight. You fought everything. You fought your family. You fought everything that came against you. Your miracle is waiting on you tonight. See, all that you fought through, everything that you walked through was not in vain, because God says you fought through it and you got here, and I am here to set you free. I am here to bring hope into the hopelessness. I am here to bring calm into your chaos. See, there is that moment. See, he was at the foot of your bed this morning when you woke up. I can't tell you how many times that I have went to bed at night worried or concerned about things that I shouldn't be worried or concerned about. And I wake up and I hear him calling my name, calling me into his presence. And he says, you know what? The things that you're carrying don't belong to you. The things that you're carrying is not what I've called you to carry. I've called you to carry a burden for a generation, but I've not called you to carry the baggage. God says, I want you to come into my presence. He wants your life to be full of freedom, full of joy, full of purpose, and full of passion. See, he has heard your wordless prayers. He has heard your deep sighs of exhaustion. You know what I'm talking about, those moments where you don't have words for what's going on in your life, those moments where all you can do is pray, those moments where you can't say a word. Someone asks you how you're doing and you just smile, faking it, trying to make them believe that you're okay, but in your prayer closet, all you can do is bend over and groan and cry out to him. He understands that language. He understands it when you come to him that way. Romans 8:26 says, meanwhile, the moment we get tired in the waiting, God's Spirit is right alongside us, helping us along. If we don't know how or what to pray, it doesn't matter. He does our praying in and for us, making prayer out of our wordless sighs, our aching groans. He knows us far better than we know ourselves, knows our pregnant condition, and keeps us present before God. That's why we can be so sure that every detail in our lives of love for God is worked into something good. See, I love stories of triumph. I love stories about people who should have died, but they didn't. People who have been through agonizing pain, who have gone through everything, but still chose to get up, but still chose to step out and say, I am going to keep running. I'm going to keep going forward. It doesn't matter what the enemy throws at me. See, I know when the bully comes knocking on the door with me, I know who to run to. I know the Father. I know who is stronger than anything that can come against me. But how many of you know, when you hear all these stories of triumph, going to movies or whatever, you're watching movies on TV or whatever about these stories of triumph, and they make you feel good. But how many of you know it feels much better when the triumph happens in your own home? When the triumph happens at your front door, when it happens in your children, when it happens in your marriage, when it happens in your finances, when it happens in your health. See, I love stories of triumph, but our family has had many issues that we have overcome, that we have come into agreement with, that God has said, I am going to bring you above. You are not the tail, you are the head, and I am going to bring you out of this. And I love it because our son, last August, almost a year ago, had to go in for total spinal reconstructive surgery. And yes, it is as bad as it sounds. And we were terrified. And there was a moment that our faith got tested. And there was a moment. He had had dreams of playing college football, and he went to college on a football scholarship. But the enemy was attacking him. We didn't know it, that he had been born with a disease, a spinal disease called Sherman's kyphosis. And it had progressed to the point that it was affecting his everyday life. He was in so much pain. And the doctor said, the only thing that's going to help you is to have total spinal reconstructive surgery. And there was a moment, and we prayed and we prayed, and we were like, God, why won't you heal him? Why won't you come to our rescue? Why won't you heal our son? He has a call on his life. He is called to change the nations. But God kept saying, I've got a bigger plan. Just hold on. I've got a bigger plan. And he went into that surgery, that seven-hour surgery, and we went into prayer. But in those times of prayer, I was sitting there and I was crying out to God, protect my son, protect my son. And God came to me in that moment, and he said, Karen, I'm with him right there at the operating table. I'm guiding the doctor's hands. I am holding him. I'm caressing his brow as he's laying there. Because the same God that met you at 13 years old, where you were a shy and insecure girl who you didn't know who you were having just a crisis of faith, the same girl that met you at 13 years old is there in the room with him. The same God that met your husband at 16 years old in his bedroom and called him to the nations is with your son. The same God that showed you a vision of your daughter in China is there with him right now. And God said, I've got him. Trust me. I've got him. And after surgery, it was the worst recovery I had ever seen. And in that hospital, we were there for an entire week where he had to have physical therapy just to be able to walk, just to learn to be able to get up and walk again. And there was one night, an amazing night, that he was laying in that bed. Pat and I were down the hall sleeping, and his beautiful wife was sleeping right next to him. And he said he was in so much pain, it felt like there was a chainsaw being ripped through his back. And he laid there, and he cried out to God, and he said, God, why have you put me here? Why won't you heal me? And he said in that moment, he didn't know if he could make it through the night. He didn't know he was on so many narcotics for pain, and he didn't know if he could make it through the night. He said in that moment, he looked up, and at the foot of his bed stood Jesus with his arms outstretched, and he said, Nate, I'm right here with you. I will never leave you. You're not alone. I will be here with you. And he said the pain did not go away, but he fell asleep in the peace and the presence of God. And I asked him later, I said, what were you thinking in that moment? And he said, I would never have went back to be healed without having the surgery, because in that moment, I realized I could never walk out. I could never abandon. I could never turn my back on the man that stood at the foot of my bed with his arms outstretched saying, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you, because he is a God that heals and sets free. But he said, if I had to go through that surgery for the rest of my life, I would never go back, because it brought me to a place of seeing my Savior. It brought me to a place of seeing his face, of seeing what he did for me. See, God says, I have called you to a place of victory. I have called you to a place of being in my presence. I love stories of triumph, because our son was not supposed to ever be able to run again like he used to. But I want you to know, last week he ran 80 miles in 8 days. And God says, see, I am a God of victory. I called you out. God is a God of restoration. He's a God of healing. It's my daughter. What the world called abandonment when she was little, God called a launching pad into her destiny. And she will change the world. That's what I'm talking about. Those moments of triumph. What the enemy meant to send you spiraling into despair and hopelessness, God wants to use as a victory, as a testimony to kick the devil in the face. That's what he's called you to. God has a massive plan. He's not asleep at the wheel. Philippians 1:6 says, there has never been the slightest doubt in my mind that the God who started this great work in you would keep at it and bring it to a flourishing finish on the day Christ Jesus appears. See, I get it. I'm not perfect. I'm a work in progress, but I will never turn my back on him. See, he told me to come and tell you, it ain't over. He's not done with you. But when doubt screams it's over, hold on. Psalms 94, 18 and 19 says, I cried out, I'm slipping, but your unfailing love, O Lord, supported me. When doubts filled my mind, your comfort gave me renewed hope and cheer. So there is still hope, and I can prove it to you. Can I share a scripture passage with you? Can I share a story in the Bible with you that absolutely frustrates me? That every time I read it, I would be so frustrated, that I would get so impatient. See, my patience gets tested in this scripture. I'm not a very patient person. And I don't pray for patience, because praying for patience requires that you be tested for patience, and I don't like to fail tests, so I just don't pray for patience. But this scripture tests my patience. But I have learned over the years that despite my whining, despite my murmuring, despite my complaining, God is still in control. There is nothing that he can't handle. There is nothing that he can't take care of. See, I want you to go with me on this journey, because Mark 5:21 says, when Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side, a large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake. Then one of the synagogue leaders named Jairus came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. He pleaded earnestly with him, my little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live. So Jesus went with him, and a large crowd followed and pressed around him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. And instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his clothes. Do you catch this? Both of them, when they heard that Jesus was coming, their response, their only response, was to get in his presence. Because she thought, if I can just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Immediately, her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once, Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. How many times have you went into your prayer closet that Jesus at once knew that you were there and that power had gone out of him? He turned around in the crowd and asked, who touched my clothes? See, many of you will relate to this story because you will have asked God, when is it my turn? When is it my turn for a miracle? See, in other words, he was asking, who pulled on my anointing? He was at the shore and he was multitasking. I love that because I'm a multitasker. He was ministering to the people. The crowd became a mob and they were pushing him and becoming a mob, and they were pushing and shoving him. But there was one woman in the crowd that touched him. See, there is a difference in being shoved and being touched. And this woman knew how to touch the Savior. But then suddenly, a man of prominence, Jairus, who probably up until this moment didn't even like Jesus. He was a religious ruler. He understood etiquette. He knew proper protocol. He knew how to be proper. But now his life had changed because his sweetheart, his little princess, his little gift from God was sick and she was dying. See, on his shoulders sat the weight of everything that was important to him. on his shoulders. See, I know all too well that little girls have a way of making you melt. Little girls have a way to make a grown man into a dress-up partner, a grown man into a tea party guest, and the prince at every ball. I understand too well because our daughter, my husband can come in from a trip from Singapore or Australia or New Zealand. He could have flown for 30 hours, hasn't had a shower, hasn't slept, hasn't had any rest. And there at the door will be greeting him, our little girl. And she'll have her phone and she'll have butterfly kisses playing and she'll say, "Daddy, dance with me." And he'll drop his suitcase, he'll drop everything in his hands, and he'll go to dance with her. Because, see, that's what the father wants to do. He says, all you have to do is meet me. All you have to do is meet me at the door, and I will drop everything, and I will come to your rescue. I will come to set you free. But everything was sitting on his shoulders. Because don't you imagine that's how Jairus felt? Don't you imagine that's how what he would have done for his daughter? But now his little girl was in trouble. Now she was sick. When he left the house, her breathing was shallow. Her fever was spiking and her body was pale. He would do anything to save his little girl. But suddenly he had faith. Suddenly he believed. Suddenly he was ready to abandon all of his doubt, abandon all of everything that was going on in his life, and say, God, if you are real, if you are truly real, then I am ready to abandon everything for you. And he runs to Jesus and he grabs him and he says, Jesus, help me. And because we serve a loving, gracious God, it's Mark 5:24 says, so Jesus went with him. And it amazes me that when we are in need as Christians, we run to the altar and we cry out to God and we say, Jesus, please go home with me. Please set me free. Please fix the situation that I'm in. But when everything is fine, when we have money in our pockets, when everything is healthy, when everything is going great, we just say, see you next week, Jesus. We'll catch you later. You're just a Sunday God. I can handle this on my own. But when there is a need, we run to the altar. See, I am tired of people thinking that all they need is on Sunday. All they need is on Wednesday. God says, I want to come home with you. I want to take residence with you. We don't need another visitation from God. We need a habitation, a move in with me God moment, a moment where we say, I'll build you a room. I'll equip my house to be a launching pad for you. I'll be a vessel for you to use. Move in with me, God. Move in with me. Walk with me. Talk with me. Go to work with me. Go to the grocery store with me. Go to the bank with me. Take up residence with me. But soon as he was walking by, suddenly, a woman touches him. The crowd interrupted this man's miracle. Don't you love that? It's over, they told him. We only had a little bit of time. See, this woman, we only had a small window of opportunity, as if God works in our time zone. Don't you love that? That we always feel like things have to be done in our time zone for it to be God. When he says, I have a better plan. I have a better time frame. If I give you what you want sometimes when you want it, then you won't understand the blessing. God says, I want to minister to you. See, this is where it gets really interesting. This is where it gets really real. This is where we realize that he really is all we need. That he really is everything. That all that we could ever think or imagine. See, it's that moment when someone else is down the altar and their miracle is taking place and we sit back and go, why can't I get my miracle? God says, can you rejoice? Can you take joy in the delight and the pleasure of me serving or me healing someone else? Can you rejoice when someone else gets healed while you're waiting for your own miracle? Yeah. Says, can you take joy? And when I heal someone, maybe your miracle got lost in the crowd. Just when you think it's your time, someone cuts in line. Someone steals your miracle. You feel like they stole your miracle, as if there is a limit to how God can heal, as if there is a limit to his blessing. But I love the scripture because it says this woman had been bleeding for 12 years. But when she heard that Jesus was coming by, she came up behind him and touched him, and immediately she was healed. Can I tell you something? I happen to believe, I don't have proof, but I happen to believe that this woman knew what she was doing. I happen to believe that for 12 years as she sat in her house because she wasn't allowed to come out because she was unclean, I happen to believe that she did her research. I happen to believe that she read in the scripture that it said that there would be one who would be coming that would have healing in their wings, that there would be a Savior that would come. See, I happen to believe that she was waiting on the Savior, that she was waiting on the one that could heal her. And when she heard that Jesus was coming, She said, I don't care if I get stoned. I don't care if I get trampled on. I don't care if I die in the process. I am going to get into the presence of God. See, there was a moment where she was studying and she knew that underneath his robe there was a prayer shawl. Underneath the robe was that tallit, that prayer life that represented his prayer life. And so what she was saying, all I have to do is touch his clothes. All I have to do is touch his prayer life. All I have to do is touch his relationship with the Father. And she knew that if she could do that she would be healed. And see, in that moment when she's walking through the crowd and Jesus turns around when she touches him and he says, who touched me? Have you ever thought about that? Have you ever thought about how absurd that statement was? Everyone was touching him. Everyone was pushing on him. I imagine when he asked the disciples and they said, are you serious, Jesus? I mean, everybody's touching you. I touched you while ago. I mean, I bet they said, Jesus, everyone is pulling on you. And he said, no, there was someone in the crowd who had desperation in their heart, who knew that what they were doing, who knew that there would be virtue that would flow out when they touched my prayer life, when they touched the relationship I had with my Father. He said, there is someone in the room. And he said, I want to bring recognition to their level of faith. That's where God wanted to bring out. He knew who touched him. He knew that she would be crawling through the crowd. He knew that her knees were bleeding. He knew that she had been bleeding for 12 long years. But he said there's going to be a moment where her testimony is going to rise up and it's going to give hope. It's going to give purpose. It's going to give vision for everyone around that will say, I can be healed as well. See, here was a man who was desperate. I believe Jesus was trying to show us something about true faith here. But this man was desperate. I imagine he says, is it really that easy to get Jesus off his game? Is it really that easy to get Jesus distracted that some woman could come along and touch him? I mean, come on, Jesus. I was here first. I have a title. I serve you every day. Surely I am more important than that woman. See, he was a religious ruler. He knew all about the scriptures. See, some of you may have felt that God has rejected your request. But sometimes rejection is protection. Sometimes isolation can be protection. Sometimes you need to raise your hands up to God and thank him for the things that answered, the prayers that you have prayed have not been answered, because he knows better for you what you need. He knows better for you that if you got some of the things that you asked for, that it would lead you down a path to destruction, that it would lead you down a path that would lead to bondage. When he says, I want freedom for you, and if you will trust me, I will bring you out. I will bring you to a new level of faith. I will bring you to a new level of freedom in my presence. See, remember, this woman was bleeding for 12 years. She was at her end. This woman was considered cursed. And he was saying, I'm the keeper of the temple. Men like him had stood out her home, outside her home, and declared her unclean. He had lost faith. He wanted a miracle, but he had lost faith for everyone else's miracle. Instead of declaring God's healing power, he had declared her unclean. See, God wants you to get to a new place. He wants you to get woke up. He wants you to have a wake-up call to jumpstart your faith. But look what happens. When this unclean woman is being healed, this nuisance, this hindrance to his miracle, didn't Jesus know that his daughter was dying? Didn't Jesus know that that may cost her her life? Mark 5:35 says, while Jesus was still speaking, some of the people came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. Your daughter is dead, they said. Why bother the teacher anymore? See, isn't that the way it happens when things go bad in your life? There's always those around you who will stand back and say, it's over, give up. Your miracle is wasted. Your miracle is gone. This lady has stole your miracle. There will always be people in your life that will say, you must have done something. You must not believe enough. You must have given up on God. But God says, just hold on, because I've got a miracle coming your way. It's a moment where we realize that in those moments of desperation, we stop asking Jesus for stupid stuff. We stop asking him for a new car. We stop asking him for a new house or a new pair of shoes or a new watch or a new purse. God says, when you're desperate enough, you start asking me, how can I get into your presence? How can I come into the Holy of Holies? How can I come into a place where I can be made whole, where I can be made clean, where I can be made new? Such a powerful moment in Scripture. But I want to talk to you about those that realized that it's not over. See, 1 Corinthians 1:7 says, just think, you don't need a thing. You've got it all. All God's gifts are right in front of you as you wait expectantly for our Master Jesus to arrive on the scene for the finale. And not only that, but God himself is right alongside to keep you steady and on track until things are all wrapped up by Jesus. God, who got you started in this spiritual adventure, shares with us the life of his son and our Master Jesus. He will never give up on you. Never forget that. He's saying, I will never leave you. I will, just like in that hospital room where he told Nate, I will never leave you. Just like when I was 13 years old and he said, if you will allow me, I will walk this journey with you. I will never leave you or forsake you. See, it's really not about those who start the race, but those who finish. It's not really about those who know the right technique, who have the right shoes, or have the running apparel. It's not about those who start the race. It's about those who get knocked down, those who fall, those who trip along the way. But they get right back up, and they keep running, and they get on the course, and they say, no matter what happens, I'm going to cross the finish line. I am going to cross the line that God has given me. See, no matter if you get knocked down, you get back up. Those who refuse to quit, those who realized against all odds, it ain't over. See, those who kept the faith regardless of the battle. It's the Shunammite woman who refused to believe that her son was dead, that rode to the man of God's home and said, declare that my son will live, because she had faith. She had faith that God would heal and raise him. It's time that we start believing and seeing those things that are not. It's time that we just start declaring. If you've got unsaved loved ones, if you've got an unsaved child that is out doing their own thing, it's time that you walk into their bedroom and you start anointing their room and you start declaring, my child will be saved. My child will walk in the power and the authority of God, that the enemy has to let go, that he has to get rid of all the grips that he has on my child, because my child will be a child of God. See, there's many of life's failures are people who didn't realize how close they were to success or how close they were to their miracle when they gave up. See, don't give up. I want to tell you, don't tell Noah that no one ever built an ark. Don't tell Moses that it was over as the bush burned and his future was marked. Don't tell Esther that it was over as she marched into the king's chamber and declared that her people would live. Don't tell Ruth that it was over as she gleaned in the field of her kinsman redeemer and landed a spot in the lineage of Christ. See, don't tell me that it's over. Don't tell me that you can't keep going. I'm talking about history makers. Do you want to be a history maker or do you want to be a statistic? See, I'm talking about, don't tell our founding fathers that we can't govern ourselves. Don't tell Abraham Lincoln that all men weren't created equal. Don't tell Rosa Parks that she has to get to the back of the bus where she knew that she deserved a front row seat. Don't tell Martin Luther King that his dreams wouldn't come true. Don't tell me that God's done with America. Don't tell me that he can't do it. Don't tell Nelson Mandela that South Africa cannot be free from apartheid, as he quoted the great Marianne Williamson. He said, our deepest fears is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fears is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant, gorgeous, talented, and fabulous? Actually, who are we not to be? You are a child of God. Your playing small does not serve the world. There is nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. We are all meant to shine as children do. And she goes on to say, it's not just in some of us, but it's in everyone. And as we let our light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. So in other words, can I tell you something? When you unconsciously choose to serve the living God, when you choose not to lay down and die, when you choose not to give in to the lies of the enemy, you give other people permission to step out and do the same. Because in your freedom, other people will be set free. See, the remnant realizes that everything is not about them, but it's about those that they are called to rescue, those that they are called to reach out and take hold of and snatch out of the pits of hell and bring into God's glorious light. See, God is able to do above and beyond all that you could ever imagine. History is full of people who should have given up, and the greatest one is Jesus. Hebrews 12:1-3 says, Do you see what this means? All these pioneers who blazed the way, all these veterans cheering us on. It means we better get on with it. Strip down, start running, and never quit. No extra spiritual fat, no parasitic sins. Keep your eyes on Jesus who both began and finished this race we're in. I love this. Study how he did it, because he never lost sight of where he was headed. That exhilarating finish in and with God. He could put up with anything along the way, cross, shame, whatever. And now he's there. In the place of honor right alongside God. When you find yourself flagging in your faith, go over that story again and again, item by item, that long litany of hostility that he plowed through, that will shoot adrenaline through your soul. See, that's it. When you start flagging, when you start going, I can't make it, look at what Jesus plowed through for you. Look what he gave up. Look what he went through so that you might be free. He said, just look at that and it'll shoot adrenaline through your soul. But in those moments, you must ignore the noise around you. And that's exactly what Jesus did in this scripture. Mark 5, 36 through 43 says, ignoring what they said, Jesus told the synagogue ruler, don't be afraid, just believe. See, there are some of you in this room who have been living a life of fear, living a life of fear of the what-ifs, the could-have-beens, the should-have-beens, all of those things. And God says, I want you to relinquish all of that. I want you to give up all the fear. See, there is a word that God wants to say to you. He says, I am no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. He is calling you out. See, it's time to get your faith back. You're following the master. Your miracle wasn't ignored. It may have just been delayed. See, God wants you to know he's in the house tonight. Everyone stand with me. See, there is a moment that you see the miracle. And all you have to do is push through the crowd. All you have to do is say, I know in whom I believe. And all you got to do is touch him. See, you've got to change the atmosphere of your house. You've got to get away from the naysayers. I love this part of the scripture. It's my favorite part. In Mark 5:37, it says, he did not let anyone follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. And when they came to the home of the synagogue rulers, Jesus saw a commotion. There's a commotion going on in your life with people crying and wailing loudly. And he went in and he said to them, why all of this commotion and wailing? Why all the worry? Why all your concern? Why all the heavy laden and the burden that you're carrying? He said, the child is not dead, just asleep. And they laughed at him. And I love this because here's what Jesus did as they laughed. Here's what Jesus did when the enemy looked at you and said, it's over. Here's what Jesus did when the enemy laughed in your face this morning when things were going wrong. Here's what Jesus does in the face of the enemy. He said, get out. Get out. When are we going to rise up and look at the enemy and say, get out? It's time for you to flee. And that's what he said. As he walked in and there were people mourning. You know what I'm talking about. It's time to cast out the professional mourners in your life. You know who I'm talking about. Those who profit from your pain. Those who glory in all of your demise. Those who glory in your despair. Those who don't just come to your pity party. They show up with decorations and snacks and everything else. See, it's time to shut the lies of the enemy. It's time to go to another level. There have been moments in my life where I have been called to go to another level, where my faith has been tested, where my faith has been at an all-time low, and I have heard the Father say, are you ready to come out? Are you ready to come out of your despair? Are you ready to come out of the pit that you have built for yourself? And he said, if you will come to another level, I will meet you there. And it's time to look at some people in your life and say, I don't know if you're going to go with me or not, but I'm going higher. I'm going into the presence of God. And if you're not going with me, I'm going to have to leave you behind. There's that moment that you have to see the miracle in the distance. And he took the child's father and the mother and the disciples who were with him, and he took them in. And Jesus said, she's just sleeping. And they laughed at him. You know you're about to get a miracle when everyone around you is laughing at your level of faith. and he put them out of the house. You've got to clean out what's stopping your faith. Change your circle of friends. Start declaring life. Proverbs 18:21 says there is life and death in the tongue. Start declaring life. Mark 5:41 goes on to say, he took her by the hand and he said, Talitha cum, which means little girl, I say to you, get up. But let me tell you something. There's another translation of that scripture, and it says that he said to her, he said, get up and wake. See, he is calling you to awaken out of your death. He is calling you to wake up from your slumber. He is calling you to wake up from the things that have held you, from the things that have ensnared you. See, it says, I command you to wake. And immediately, the girl walked around, and she was 12 years old. And at this, they were completely astonished. Why? Why were they astonished? Because that is should be the norm. And he told them to give her something to eat. He said, give her something to eat, because he was saying, church, we have to feed our faith. We have to feed our faith. We have to testify of his goodness. Tell the world of all that he has done. But there is a moment, and I wanted you to know in this room, God is telling me to say to you, it's time for you to wake up. It's time for your faith to wake up. Begin to cry out right now, because I believe that God wants to do a miracle in this place, because he is calling you to awaken to the things of God. He is calling you to awaken to the things that have held you back. He is calling you to awaken out of your lethargy, out of your complacency. He has called you to waken up, to wake up and declare that he is the king that can set you free, that can heal you. Any addiction has nothing, because he can set you free in a moment. If your marriage is in trouble, he says, awaken to my power. Awaken to my love that can consume your marriage, that can consume your life. He's saying, wake up. Strengthen that which remains. Strengthen that which remains inside you. He's calling you. He's calling out to you. If you want to know a Savior that will never leave you, that will never forsake you, he is calling you to wake up. Wake up. I just keep hearing it in my spirit. He says, wake up, church. Wake up, church. Wake up, church. Wake up to my power. Wake up to my authority. Wake up to my purpose. Wake up to my love and my grace for you. Wake up to the healing power that I have. Wake up that what I have to offer you is not fleeting. What I have to offer you is not just another church service. It's a moment where you take up residence with me. It's a moment where you walk in his presence on a daily basis, where you don't bow to culture, where you don't bow to everything that faces you throughout the day. Begin to cry out right now, because his presence is in this place. It's walking through. The Holy Spirit is walking through, and he's wanting to touch you. He's wanting to touch you in a way that you have never experienced before. He wants you to come into a place of submission to his Holy Spirit, to where you wake up in the morning and you feel his presence. When you go to bed at night, you feel his presence, where all fear is cast out. If you are desperate for him tonight, if you are truly desperate, if you are that woman and you say, I have got to get to Jesus, that I don't care what I have to get through. If you are desperate, then get to this altar right now. Come and cry out. Come to this altar with boldness, because I imagine that woman, she didn't care what anybody thought. She didn't care if her makeup was running. She didn't care if her clothes looked right. She didn't care if people laughed at her. She didn't care if people were calling her names. All she cared about was there as a healer. There was a man that she heard about, and his name was Jesus. And she knew if she could reach him, she would be healed. Don't stop crying out. See, to your level of desperation, that is where he will meet you tonight. Your level of desperation is what's going to bring down that power, that authority, that purpose. Freedom. freedom in Jesus' name. How desperate are you tonight?